is talking at me. I can't hear a word they're saying. Only the echoes of my mind. People stop and stare. I can't see their faces.
Let's have Limerick. Hello, David.
Hi, Nick. You well?
Yeah, good, thanks.
Good, good. I'll be honest with you, Nick. I think the man's a legend. You know, I've heard you for the past 45 minutes talk about the man. How can you, you know, how can you say that about the man?
Well, okay, go on. Legend.
So how's he a clown?
Well, how is he a legend?
You know, the man's come from nothing. Him and his, if you actually look at the facts and if you look at, you know, everything, you know, you've heard him from Greta Thunberg. If you actually look at the man's actually, you know, 10 years ago, he's eating KFC from a bin with him and his brother. He's a success story. He's a success story. And that's, you know, you're talking about kids. I'm 37-year-old, Nick. And, you know, we've got to look at it. You know, kids, they want to, you know, you're talking rap music. This ain't Tupac and Biggie. We're not talking about guns. And that's, you know, the man's talking about facts. He's talking about how to make money, how to be successful.
How do you make money? How do you make money and be successful?
Yeah, well, you know, look at, if you actually look at his videos, Nick, you know, first of all, go to the gym, get a positive mindset.
Well, you don't make any money by going to the gym.
Do you not think?
Well, I know you don't, unless you own the gym.
No, absolutely not. You go to the gym, it gives you a positive mindset, and it lets you, you know, decide for the day. It's a fact.
Right, what do you do for a living, David?
What do I'm glad you asked. I was actually on the dole about 3.5 years ago now. I've actually went from driving a Ford Fiesta to a £100,000 Ford Taycan. Electric. I can't stand it.
Right. What do you do for a living, David?
I've got my own energy brokerage.
You've got your own energy brokerage?
Yes.
Right. I don't really know. I have any idea what
you
that
don't
means.
Know? Okay, let me explain the facts, Nick. Okay. So I was homeless. I now, you know, suppliers, I've looked at suppliers now make a lot of money in the UK. You know, energy crisis is high. When do we look, when, you know, if you're going to be a successful person in the UK, when do we look at it? Crisis. That's how you make your money. So what I've done, I've been basically the middleman. You know, I buy energy from the supplier and I sell it to the business energy sector. You know, you can speak on the radio and, you know, talk, you know, like, I don't know what I'm talking about. It's an absolute fact. I've gone from nothing to something. And you're talking about the gym. You know, I struggled in my life, you know, depression, anxiety. I've gone to the gym. I've been in good shape and I feel better about myself.
Right. And it's all because of this clown, Andrew Tate. You know what, David? I don't really believe you any more than I believe this text. You probably sent this. It says, Andrew Tate is not only influential on young kids, his behaviour and actions fueled my motivation and ambition to achieve my goal of becoming a self-made millionaire within 1 year. Say what you want about him, but Tate is the male role model most young men have been missing for years. It sounds like you wrote that, David, and I don't believe you or that text. Zummerzet. Hello, John.
Oh, hello, Nick.
John.
Hello, how are you?
I'm great, mate.
Good. Happy New Year.
It's been a while
since we spoke.
Yeah.
Yeah. All this furore about... is that the word? Furore about Prince Harry again?
A furore. It's not a Farage.
For the nutcase.
Not a Farage. A furore.
Yeah.
An aurora.
All this. It's terrible, isn't it? I mean, one of the big revelations in his book is that he says that he killed... How many? 25,000
Taliban.
Yeah. Well, 25,000? Really?
Yeah. Go on.
That many?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I just think that, you know, it's caused a bit of a fuss, hasn't it, and this, that, and the other, but, you know, someone somewhere who works for the Taliban is sat there thinking, well, like...
Well, in an administration level, you mean, or actually at the front line?
Somewhere on the front line, but right. Maybe retired.
Yes.
He's thinking, well, I killed at least 25 gingers.
Mm.
So maybe we're quits. But I don't know. I thought you'd laugh at that.
Yeah, it sounds like a listener with material to me.
Oh, no.
Yeah, if you look up in the night sky, John, even down as far as Somerset, you might see an aurora borealis. And in other news, you're a roaring borealis. My favourite line from Cheers. Oh, hello, Charles.
Hi, Nick.
Charles.
Merry New Year.
Yes.
I think I got that one right.
Thanks.
And, you were talking about floods earlier, but floods aren't good things.
Who says they're good
things? I got flooded in June 2007, and I lost a picture of myself smiling. With teeth as well.
Yeah.
And, you lose things, it's not good, it's not good.
What are you talking about, Charles? Whoever said that floods were a good thing?
Well, come to think of it, absolutely no one.
No one whatsoever. No, that's right. You sounded awfully like a listener with material to me.
Oh, no.
Let's hope that wasn't his material. Maybe he was building up to it. We'll never know. Concert, Sean.
How are you doing, mate? You all right? I've got two quick points for you, Nick, right?
Yes.
Why don't the means test it, like benefits? Say if you've got £1 million, like, in the bank, right?
Mm.
Why the hell do you need free treatment?
Right. If you had if you had £1 million in the bank, I very much doubt that you'd be going to the NHS. You'd be straight to a private health facility.
That's the way things are going in the NHS. They've got millions in the bank, but they still go to the NHS.
Well, I doubt it.
You know, that's a problem.
I don't see that. I don't really reckon that's true. I mean, if you had the money. If you had a seven-figure sum in the bank, then it's very unlikely that you'd put up with being stuck on a waiting list to relieve whatever is ailing you that could stretch till past your dead. What's the other point, Sean?
There's not millions of pounds worth of people, right, that have got millions of pounds getting free treatment on the NHS. Do you think that's not happening, like?
I don't think that that's a major issue. What's your other point?
Get rid of the TV license, right? And let everyone pay £100, right, towards the NHS. Get rid of the TV license and say £100 a year, every household pay towards the NHS.
What's it got to do with the TV license?
Well, the TV license is a waste of space.
Well, not to the people that watch or listen to the BBC, it's not.
Well, why don't they just show adverts, mate? What is the point? What is the problem with the BBC showing adverts? They do it anyway for internet.
Well, I'm not talking about the BBC. It has absolutely nothing to do with what we're talking about. Litchfield, hello, Steve.
Hi, Nick.
Steve.
Yeah, I voted for Brexit. I'm glad I did.
Yeah.
And it's the way forward.
And so how has life improved since?
Well, the fishermen in Brixham are more happy.
No, they're not. They're not. No,
they are.
No.
I've listened to them on Radio 4. The fishermen generally are happier in Brixham. I've listened to their...
The fishermen are absolutely not happier. They feel as though they have been betrayed, which is of course completely true.
Now I've listened to the collective in Brixham fishermen talking on Radio 4.
Well, I can assure you that's Jacob Rees-Mogg's point. They're British fish and all the happier for it. It's a complete nonsense. Of all the industries to bring up, but Steve, the fishing industry is the one that has been screwed over the most. They were useless. They're sort of put on the flag of Brexit, and this is how we're going to regain our sovereignty. We'll get our fish back. But the absolute opposite happened. I think you have been sadly misinformed. Let's have Liverpool. Hello, Colin.
Hello.
Colin.
Hi.
Yes, sir.
No, I'm just been listening, and I'm just thinking like word or letters that represent stuff off the ear, and I'm just thinking, why has this government spent millions of pounds on a life-ending drug and nobody ever talks about it.
A life-ending drug?
Midazolam.
Right, well, Midazolam. I don't know anything about that.
You may not know anything about it, but it's not pretty hard to research. You can actually see what it is.
Are you giving me homework?
Sorry?
Is this you giving me homework? But, sir, it's Christmas.
You ask for words of the year, and these are words that are not actually spoken about.
Right.
And these are words that...
Well,
you know,
I'll tell you what, how do you spell it?
Excuse me?
Using letters, how do you spell it?
Actually, somebody's actually speaking about it on air right now.
Somebody is speaking about... Yeah, it's you. So, his other half is listening to the radio saying, somebody's speaking about it on LBC right now. Yeah, you are. Is this real life or am I hallucinating? Peterborough. Hello, Maurice.
Nick, good evening. And stop whinging, moaning and getting on.
Who, me?
Whinging and whining and moaning.
Yes.
Exactly. You entirely, yes. I'm only putting it back.
Putting what back?
Well, to you.
Right.
Anyway, well, Bodger's doing what all the other MPs are doing.
Not much.
Nothing at all. And, well, mine is absolutely appalling. He's an absent MP. He's conservative, of course. He's
right.
Conservative, of course.
Yes.
And He didn't even know where this part of his constituency was until 8 years ago when I challenged
Peterborough.
Him.
Peterborough?
No, well, you see, the sad thing is, whilst I live in Peterborough, my constituency is not actually Peterborough. It is northwest Cambridgeshire.
Is it?
Which is utterly bizarre because Peterborough, as a city, is a unitary authority. But my constituency, whilst I live within the bounds of Peterborough,
yes,
is northwest Cambridgeshire. I hate
well, that's, all of that. That's very, very interesting, Maurice.
But it isn't at all, Nick, to you. Because, and I know,
please,
don't get up and eat with me.
Please tell me more about that whole unitary thing.
Well,
Just don't.
Exactly.
Right.
Thank you. You've let me off the hook there. Thank you. That's the only time you've ever let anybody off the hook.
Putting the phone on the hook in just a minute. Carry on.
Well, I telephoned to say that the conversation about Harry and Meghan is all the fault of the media, because it's only the media talking about it. None of us are.
Well, that's not true.
We don't care.
No, that's not true. If you did not care, if the people of this country didn't care and therefore did not read those stories, they would stop writing them straight away. Believe me, that is true.
Well, how can we not see or hear them when we're being bombarded relentlessly and no other news is being reported?
You cannot click on them online. They know what stories people are clicking on, which is why they keep writing stories about David Beckham's kids. People keep clicking on them. The Kardashians, they keep clicking on them. That's why they keep writing them. If you stop clicking on those stories, they would stop writing them.
I am not guilty of any of that. I am not guilty of any of that.
Right.
And by the way, I love Rose, your previous caller.
Right.
She sounds absolutely wonderful.
Okay, have you got a pen and paper, Maurice? I'll give you her address.
Yes, I do.
Okay. Herne Hill. Hello, Arthur.
Oh, hey. How's it going?
Good, thanks.
Yeah, good. I was just calling about a comment you made about artificial intelligence, and when we were talking about maths earlier and the importance of it in education, you said something about creative industries being the ones that may potentially be the most important and maybe more emphasis.
Not most important. No, I didn't say that.
Well, it was quite a long time ago.
Least likely to be taken over by robots.
Okay, well, that is something that I would contradict, because I think that actually the creative industries are significantly under threat from artificial intelligence.
In what way? But when you say creative industry, what do you mean?
Well, have you heard of a couple of apps called Lender and even ChatGPT?
Yeah, ChatGPT.
Okay, so ChatGPT can write pretty good poetry in a matter of seconds, and Lender can produce pretty good self-portraits for, I think, £3. You get 50 or 60 of them. And people are using them, like, really a lot. And
when you say self-portraits, do you just mean a likeness?
Well, it's more than that, really, because, like, you upload a... My understanding is you upload a bunch of pictures of yourself, and then it produces a 50 or 60 different self-portraits.
Yeah, well, I can get one of those for a fiver from one of the guys that sits and does cartoons of people in Leicester Square.
Yeah, true, but you couldn't get 50 or 60 of them across 10 different styles in the standard that they're being produced. And it's interesting because I think in the 1960s, when futurists and sci-fi writers were writing about artificial intelligence, the argument that was being made was that, we will use artificial intelligence to take the burden off working people, and everyone will, be able to spend more time on creative pursuits.
Yes.
But nowadays, I think the way that artificial intelligence is going is that it's so good at reading what we actually want, that like scripts, poems, portraits are actually more under threat than people give credit, and the artistic industries are just as under threat as the numerical ones.
Right. I seriously doubt that that's true. I mean, there will always be people who want art that just looks nice, and like a robot, will be able to produce that. You know, be able to paint a picture of a flower that looks like a flower. But they won't be able to do Picasso. They won't have the imagination of Dali. They won't be able to draw a flower like Paul Origo. None of these things. So you may be partly right. They will be able to do certain things that we do, but it will lack that humanness that is essential in the arts. It just will. Or otherwise, we might as well just give up. I mean, if that's the attitude, then let's just not do anything. Tynmouth, David.
Good morning.
Yes, David.
Good morning. Yeah, I couldn't disagree with you more. I'm a great supporter of William and Catherine, because they set stability. And in the country and the world at the moment, what we need more than else is a stable, even possibly boring society, rather than all the chaos that we have and we're living with, or trying to live with at the moment. And
well, what's the point? What is the point of a boring monarchy?
To add stability.
How do they do that? Then?
You could trust the Queen. The Queen was the most magnificent woman, and you didn't say anything against her when she was alive. So you only coming to light now. Your criticism of her. She.
I think your pet is staging an intervention, David. Feltham, Ian.
Good evening, Nick.
Ian.
I did know what I was voting for, and I knew, being part of a bloc for 50 years, it would take more than 2 years to actually sort it out.
What do you mean by sort it out?
Well, let's see. We've got to realign our economy, not to be mainlining on cheap East European labourers to undermine the wages and conditions of carers and lorry drivers.
So you mean, to mean by sorted out, you mean reap the benefits?
Well yes, but, right. How I voted, you see, I voted because 60 women have been raped and 10 murdered over the tree.
Right, well, that's no real reason to vote to leave the European Union, Ian. In fact, that's an extraordinary thing to say. I believe that my producer prevented you from hearing that, but never mind. But your basic point was that we need to wait in order to reap the benefits. And I've heard this from callers on this subject, and I've heard this from politicians who proposed that the best thing to do for our freedom and sovereignty is to vote leave. However, those were also the very same politicians who said that clothes and footwear will be cheaper the moment we leave the European Union. Boris Johnson said gas and electricity will be cheaper when we leave the European Union. The bus that everybody saw and whose inhabitants now claim didn't exist said that £350 million would be provided every week to spend on the NHS. They said that we held all the cards, that we would be able to secure our borders, and that food, I think it was Daniel Hammond said this, food would be cheaper by 7% on day one. So you cannot tell people to do something for immediate benefits and then when they do it, say, oh, well, it'll be 10 years or 20 years. I think Jacob Rees-Mogg actually said 50. I mean, it's just staggering that you can persuade people in their millions to do something by telling them it would improve their lives immediately and then say, once they've done it, that they're going to have to wait till probably after they're dead to reap the benefits. It's just... And that people are still sticking up for it is just mind-blowing. Camden, hello, Max.
Hi there. Yes, I'm sorry to sort of bring up the dreadful... the Harry and Meghan saga again.
Yes.
It's just that... I don't know whether you agree, but it's difficult to process the information for me because it does affect me because it involves the monarchy. And I think that's the case for a lot of people. In other words, it's quite something fundamental to most people's lives.
Is it?
Therefore...
Fundamental?
You know what I mean? They kind of think, where am I standing? Well, this is where I am. I just think, where do I stand on this?
It's not fundamental, though. It's an amusement. The royal family are an amusement, like EastEnders are an amusement. Well, it's true.
Well, I think it's more than that. I think, you know, it's kind of, I'd feel a bit kind of like, oh, that's gone, if it went.
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
But people would be upset if EastEnders got took off air.
Exactly, but...
Got took off air. Did you just hear me saying that?
For the same reason, you know. Yeah.
let's not quibble. You know, people feel very strongly about the royal family, yeah.
They're very attached to it, put it like that.
Right.
And also, you know, on a sort of vaguely serious point, they do a hell of a lot for charity.
Oh, God.
And,
no, they don't.
You know, they really, really, really do.
They don't.
They do.
What do they do? How much money did they give to charity last year?
It's a question of...
None. Zero. Not a penny.
No. I know. Well, I don't want to sort of...
They just collect honorary presidencies of charities, or whatever they call it. I mean, I bet Charles is the president of about 1,000 charities. So how could he possibly do anything for any of those charities other than be their figurehead?
I know, but what I'm saying is being their figurehead does make a difference to how much money the charity can collect sometimes.
Well, I don't see why. Why? I mean, people are people. Well, I don't know. Is that true? People are. I think that probably is true. I'm going to let you get away with that. But just because the royal family, a member of the royal family, is the figurehead of a charity, doesn't mean to say that you've got to. I mean, if somebody was rattling a tin for the blind or people who are suffering PTSD from being in the military. Are you going to ask them which member of the royal family, if any, is their titular figurehead? Of course not.
No, I'm just saying, can I just gently say that I think, when I said people, what I meant by that was that, as you can see from the sympathy that I find as absurd as you do for Harry and Meghan, or Harry...
Sympathy?
Or whatever.
I'm not detecting sympathy.
I'm detecting a lot of people that called in to earlier LBC call-ins. Yes, they're saying, poor Harry, I do understand. It must be terrible, you know.
Poor Harry, because he's been taken from us by that evil, wicked witch, Meghan. Yeah, I've heard that a lot.
I love that you have a cartoon outlook, and it's probably very true.
Yeah.
But
people think of him as that kid that used to go mental. He's not. He's twice that age now. He's not that child anymore.
I know,
he didn't get stolen from us by some dreadful harpy.
Well, okay. Let, maybe I should skip over all these potential arguments, because I'm sure we both agree at heart.
Right.
But all I was going to say is the way people can be manipulated, that's my point.
Absolutely.
And they want to be manipulated because they feel happier doing that.
Exactly.
Therefore, that's why having a royal as a head of a charity and turning up and just, I saw him, actually works.
Well, it doesn't really, because they only show, I mean, if you're head of 200 or 300 charities, how many times in a 10-year period would you actually be able to show up?
They do work. That's my point. Anyway, let's skip over that.
Yes.
I don't want to argue with you because I think you're fantastic and I love the show. So the main point I was going to make, which is I was personally, which has nothing to do with you or me or anybody else, I was trying to sort of reconcile why I feel uncomfortable about what's going on. In other words,
what do you mean about what's going on? What is going on? What
with Harry and Meghan's publicity and, you know, sort of having kind of sort of complete diarrhea about everything that's happened in his life.
Also known as sharing. I mean, the man's written a book about himself.
That's the whole point. And I thought, there are people who like it and say, I've seen him in a different light now. You know, you think to yourself, well, I'm trying to understand why you're saying that, you know. So, in other words, all I'm trying to say, I feel like, should I be missing something? Should I feel sorry for him? Should I be empathetic to him? Am I being kind of old-fashioned?
I've just avoided reading anything about it. I mean, I didn't really want to talk about it very much because...
I'm sorry.
No, that's fine. It's half of every newspaper in the land. It's the front page story in every single newspaper, I think, except The Guardian and The Financial Times. Only they have some sort of grounding in reality. Everyone else has completely lost their mind. And they're doing it because a man wrote an autobiography. Imagine criticising anybody else for writing an autobiography by saying, why are you writing about yourself and your life? Why can't you just keep it to yourself? It's an autobiography.
He's never done anything. You know what I mean? Himself. Anyway, I'm sorry to get carried away, but all I was going to say was this.
You keep saying that all I was going to say was... And
it's a punchline. It's a punchline.
Oh, no. Right, go on then.
Well, no, but it's not a punchline, funny punchline. It's just like, I can't really say anything after I said this.
Yes.
So I'm just keeping myself on air, I'm sorry.
Carry on.
It's this.
And finally,
And finally, thank you. Thank you very much. Is this.
Get on with it.
I will, I promise. I've forgotten it. No, I haven't. The whole point is, what I've come down to after I've processed all the information, is why I feel disturbed by the whole thing.
Right.
Is that the royal family, at least, including our lovely dear departed Queen, and also the remaining royal family, at least are serving and try to serve the public.
Oh, please.
The whole point
is,
that's their job. Whether you think they're doing a good job or not, that is their role. And Prince Harry...
That's the idea, but they don't really serve us. It's the other way round. We've talked around in circles for a good long while there, Max. So thanks for that. Maidstone, hello, Robert.
Thank you.
Thank you.
How are you, by the way?
I'm super. Thanks for asking.
Good. It's always lovely to speak to you. You know, I was rattling into the BBC today, but I know it's not your same company. And then the absolute rubbish that's going on in this country at the moment.
Awful.
I mean, James is incredible because...
Who?
You know, no one is negotiating, are they?
James?
You're James, aren't you?
I'm going to put you on hold, Robert. As soon as James comes in, I'm going to put you through. Ealing, hello, Simon.
Hi, thank you for an absolutely great show.
Simon.
I was thought-provoked by your statement that most religions are
misogynistic. And I just want to challenge the concept that Christianity is misogynistic. And it ties in with...
You don't think so?
Well, I'm not a theologian.
Well, no, me either. I know precious little about religion, but just look at the religious leaders. How many of them are women?
Right. So, first point is that the practice of a religion doesn't necessarily reflect the theology and the principles behind that religion.
I'm talking about the practice. I'm talking about what actually happens, not what the thought process, the thoughts behind it are, or what Jesus himself said, because what Jesus said doesn't really, in my eyes, have much correlation to how the religion is prosecuted in his name.
Right. So Jesus made some quite unique claims that he was the Son of God himself, which is not common to a lot of other religions. There's a myth, I guess. There's a preconception about Christianity that it's a set of rules that must be followed. But actually, the Bible is basically the Old Testament and the New Testament.
Right. We're getting bogged down into the interpretation of the Bible itself. I'm talking about the way religion is actually run. How many women are at the top table in any religion that you can think of? Zero.
Not reserved, but probably less than there should be. There should be probably a lot more. But I guess the fundamental point is I'm trying to make is who do we look up to in society? And Christianity gives a message of looking up to Jesus, but it doesn't necessarily say that we're human beings match up to those expectations. But it's not a set of rules that we must follow, but more an aspiration to look at Jesus to satiate our lives.
Right. I think if the people that run religions and yell about it and throw religion in our face actually acted in the way that Jesus would recognise, then it wouldn't be quite so toxic. Crystal Palace. Hello, Tony.
Oh, hi, Nick.
Tony.
Oh, hi there. Yeah, would I still vote for Keir Starmer? 100% yes. What other choices there, first of all?
There's lots of other choices. There's the Conservatives. If you don't like them, then there's the Lib Dems. There's the Green Party. Lots of choices.
Yeah, I don't mind the Green Party, but they've only got one MP. Firstly, I think the main thing is compassion in this country has completely gone out the window since the referendum. And the main thing is, I don't know, I can't put myself inside someone else's mind, but I think he generally cares, and that's what matters to me. He is in a completely impossible situation with regards to Sadiq Khan, because we all know what the voting is like. Look, I'm 31, and I'm a pro-Remainer completely through and through, and I did not vote because I thought it was a foregone conclusion. And I did not vote.
What, in the referendum?
I did not vote at all, no. But I'm a pro-Remainer.
How could you possibly have been that sure before a result that was so tight?
Well, I didn't really know it was going to be that tight, to be honest.
Well, no, underlines the importance of always, always voting.
Well, exactly. I'm sort of like the campaigner with especially my younger friends, to vote, and they don't really get anything about politics. And I've taken a much bigger interest in it the last probably the 5 or 6 years before that.
But what is your thoughts then on Keir Starmer's position? I mean, as much as he actually has one, he's like just a ditto. It's like whatever the government said, ditto.
No, I don't think so, because I actually quite like him. Like I said, I think he generally cares. He's got the party in charge. Like, I quite like Theresa May, if I'm being honest. I didn't vote for her, of course.
You do a lot of not voting, Tony.
Yes, I know, but I've started that since 2019.
Right.
That's just how I've been brought up, to be honest.
To not vote?
Yeah, well, not vote, but, you know, my nan and my mum absolutely adore, what's his name, Rees-Mogg. And I just, I know, yeah, exactly. I think they're sort of like getting the hint now, and it's like with Boris Johnson, I could see beneath him before, and I think they can, but they were like, oh, I love his personality, and it's excruciating,
well,
to be honest.
Well, never engage with them in political discussion over the dinner table, Tony. That's my recommendation. Thanks for that. Here's a call in Sweden. Anthony.
Hey, good evening.
Anthony.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, what would you like to say?
Excellent. Yeah, I'd like to say, I've been listening to you guys for a long time talking about this situation, this problem. And I was at work today and I heard a young lady saying, oh, I've got this toothache, I've been to the dentist and they cost me thousands and thousands of kroner, which is hundreds of pounds. She goes, but my sister who lives in London goes, oh, come to London, I'll take care of it for you. And I thought, okay, cool. And I'm sitting there thinking, as the next Londoner, all righty, nice one. And I thought, this is ridiculous. But here's the thing, the system in Sweden is quite simple. If you go to the doctors or you go to the hospital any time, it costs you £10, which is like, let's just say 100 kroners.
Mm.
That's what it costs you, £10, 100 kroners, every time you go.
Yeah.
And then if you go 10, 15 times, then it's like within a year, within one year, then it's free after that. And then you have a card and your numbers on there, your national insurance numbers on there, it's all on there.
It's the same system that they have in France and Germany and Spain and so on and so on. And those that can't actually afford that, they are taken care of as they are in this country.
Those are the ones that are wasting people's time. Because the people that are wasting people's, the doctor's time, the nurse's time, everyone's time, who ain't got that £10, they're not going to be wasting their time. Do you remember the days when people were ringing up 999 to say, oh, my son's got a bit of...
But I don't think the two are connected. I don't think not having £10 means that you would be wasting a doctor's time by presenting yourself to them. I don't really understand the connection between that.
Well, the connection between that is quite simply, if you're someone who's whatever, and you've got £10 in your pocket, you're not going to waste that £10 to go to the doctor with someone say, like, I've got a cough. Oh, I hit my toe. Oh, I did this. Oh, I did that. Oh, I fell over. You're not going to do that. If you are someone who's serious and does have a serious ailment...
He forgot himself for a moment there and didn't remember that he was on the radio. Never mind. I didn't really understand what point he was trying to make. I think just because you're poor does not necessarily mean that you are wasting a doctor's time if you go and see him. That rather mystified me. I didn't get that at all. Tottenham, hello, Tom.
Hello, Nick.
Tom.
I forgot what I was calling about a while ago, but now I'm wondering.
Yes.
Got a very precise tally on the kill rate. How many women has he knocked? Has he got a precise tally? Has he written them all down?
I don't know, Tom. Let's investigate further. Brighton. Hello, Ben.
Oh, hi. Thank you so much for the call.
Ben.
It's a couple of things, really. My brother-in-law is very, very unwell at the moment. He's it's quite upsetting for me to talk about it, actually. But very serious illness. And he's had tremendous difficulty actually seeing the consultants he needs and all the rest of it, yeah? Whereas me, being a complete nitwit and twit, yeah, I keep breaking hands and stuff because I box a lot, yeah? And when I do break my hands, I go to... They see me immediately, essentially. So I can go to... Because... hand breakages, I've broken, I think, of my 27 bones in my hand, I think I've broken about 21 or 22 in both hands. They see me always immediately because they know that I'm, that it'll cause nerve damage. Whereas they don't see my brother-in-law that actually probably needs the care that I really don't need.
Right.
And I think it's really down to funding. I think it's really down to the fact that I'm an easy person to see. I can be sorted out. They can bandage me up and send me off.
Right.
Whereas my brother-in-law, he's a very difficult person to see, and he will cost a fortune. And what I worry about is the fact that all these cuts have actually damaged people who really need care and not twits like me, basically.
Right. Okay, thanks, Ben. Chelsea, hello, Mark.
Oh, hello, can you hear me okay?
Yes, Mark.
Yes, I know we've crossed swords before. We agree 99% of the time. And I just want to say that I disagree with you that this is not the first place that's created free healthcare. Cuba, which has superior vaccinations and healthcare and a lot less, well, no street children compared to the child-bombing America that gave every sanction under the sun on its border, okay, a water border, right, next,
well,
to it.
We're not talking about America's relationship with Cuba or the BBC. We're talking about the NHS. Can we stick to the topic, please? Hull, hello, Jack.
Hi, Nick.
Jack.
Now, I know the Tories aren't doing a great job at the moment, and the likelihood is they're going to get kicked out of the next election, which, to be honest, quite scares me. Now, don't get me wrong, I don't think Tories are doing a brilliant job. I'm more scared that Labour will do a worse job.
Why?
Why? Because of their track record. They didn't do a fantastic job last time.
Well, that's not true. The waiting lists were the shortest I think they'd ever been when Tony Blair was in power. There were more hospital beds, there were more doctors, there were more GPs, there were more nurses. I mean, what are you after?
When it came to the NHS, yes, they did do a better job than the Tories are doing.
That's what we're talking about.
Yeah, but the rest of the economy, which, you know, I don't want to get sidetracked onto that, but the rest of the economy went to... Yeah,
we've never owed more money as a country. We've never had taxes as high as they are. We've never had more unfilled jobs. What are you on about, Jack?
Well, the point I rang up about was the NHS. Like I said, the Tories are likely to get kicked out the next time around. So why don't they do something radical and overhaul the NHS and do it properly? You know, get rid of all the top managers. Well, not all of them, but thin them down. Look at the purchasing of products. From what I've heard, the some are paying like £2 for items, whereas another trust is paying £13 for the same item.
Right, is that not the fault of the Conservatives who split up the NHS into all these tiny little, well, not tiny, but into these separate entities that had to pay on the market?
Wasn't it Labour who did that?
I don't think it was.
Okay. Well, as I was saying, I think Tories should overhaul it all. Have, like we're doing at the moment, pay us with national insurance, but also have some kind of the American system where you take out insurance if you can afford it.
Not the American system. That is the absolute worst thing that we could possibly do, but I fear that that is where this government is taking us. There are other systems other than this one and the American one, and yet not people always, but the amount of times that I've heard that, oh, we can't change the NHS because then we will have what they've got in America, no one in their right mind should follow the American system. It would be just absolutely catastrophic, but again, I feel that that's where we're going. Here's a call in Enfield. Wes. Yes, Wes.
Yeah, hi.
Wes.
Yeah, here. I'm still here.
You're still there. I'm over here. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Yes, Wes. Where are you?
I'm in Enfield.
Enfield. Well, you should have said.
Yeah.
Yes, Wes. What would you like to say?
Yeah, I was just listening, just to a brief clip about you're talking about Harry and Meghan, obviously, Harry's,
Well, I was trying not to, but people keep bringing it up all the time. Go on.
Yeah, it's just that I just find it a little bit strange. It's just that you guys are having to defend somebody who's not very bright. Because what I mean by that is that if somebody else has basically just got on record and bragged that they just killed 25 brown people and then describe them as chess pieces, then the whole world will be in uproar. But because it's Harry, he gets a free pass. You see what I mean?
No, I don't. It's the other way around. If anybody had said that it's disgraceful that an ex-military person was talking about killing people in a war, then the press would have said, you unpatriotic woke snowflakes, that's what war's like, get used to it.
No, but the fact is, he's actually bragged about it, and he just described them as chess pieces. Now,
yeah, well, how else are you going to think about it? I mean, you try to put it out of your mind, I imagine, if you're actually killing real-life human beings, especially if you're doing it from a distance, you're just doing your job. So you try not to... you try to dissociate yourself from what is actually going on, which I imagine is like coping mechanism for a lot of people in the military.
Yeah, perhaps, but if, for example, what I'm saying is, if it's somebody like Jeremy Clarkson was to say that, then the whole world would be in uproar, wouldn't they? They'd be saying that.
No,
well,
they just wouldn't believe it. They wouldn't believe that any helicopter could get off the ground with Jeremy Clarkson in it. No offence. Selzy, Maxine, what could possibly go wrong?
Oh, well, it'll all go wrong, my flower. How are you, my darling? You're right.
Oh, my God, you're loud.
Oh, no, yeah, well, I hear you complaining about some people when they don't talk insta phone.
Yes.
I'm actually out in the street, my love, so everyone can hear me if they're not even tuned into LBT. Anyway, forget about Harry. The news about Harry, forget about
well,
that.
Well, hang
forget
on a minute. Hang on. Wait. I had forgotten about him, and then you reminded me about him.
Damn it! Sorry. Right. Well, forget about all the news that is going on. I've got serious news.
Big news.
I had a very bad experience this morning. Now, I listen to LBC throughout the night, right?
Yeah.
So I have to set three alarms, one at 7 o'clock, one at 7:15, one at 7:30, so I'm not late for work. During the night, I'll get up for a little... Well, I do, because I like to still sit in bed.
Yes.
Anyway, so I'll get up in the night to go for a little wee-wee, and I'll put the light on my radio.
Yes.
But it's only a little light, so I don't trip over me dog. Anyway...
Is that a euphemism for something else, or is it an actual dog?
No, it is a dog. It's an a actual, little big John dog. Yeah, one of them little poodly. I know.
It's not a yappy dog, is it?
No, it's not.
Is that a yes?
Anyway. No.
Okay,
Anyway, what happens is 7 o'clock alarm goes off, right, so I'll still stay in bed. 7:15, one goes off. So I get set up and put the big light on. Well, Jesus, God help us. I look on the ceiling and there it is. The biggest ginormous spider you ever seen in your life, right?
I bet it's not as big as the one that I found in the bath relatively recently.
Yeah, they were right in the bath. When they're above your bed and you're asleep in bed, they ain't the nicest of creatures.
That's
anyway,
a good point. Did you take a photograph of it?
No, what happened was
I took a photograph of mine, and I thought, I'll take a photograph. This is an unusually large spider, I thought. I've never seen one even remotely this big outside of a zoo, I thought. So I'll take a picture of it, and then I'll try to match it to, you know, multiple pictures of spiders that I'll look up on the internet. But then I just couldn't face looking up multiple pictures of spiders on the internet. So it's still on my phone. It's in there somewhere, waiting.
No. Get rid of it. Anyway, what happened was, I screamed my head off. Well, my boyfriend, Mike, is 6'5", and he wondered what was going on. There's me. Mm. You don't have to picture this, but there's me naked in the bedroom, Mike, screaming my head off at this spider.
Yes.
Anyway, he goes, quick, get it. So I ran in the bathroom, grabbed a load of toilet paper, I goes, just squash it. He goes, it's a big fella, isn't it?
Yeah.
I went, you know what I mean? But you've got to get rid of it.
You squash something that big and you have to redecorate.
Well, no. What happened was the twig, it gets up on the bed to catch it, right? And I'm thinking he squashed it.
Yes.
And then all of a sudden he drops it on the bed.
Oh, my God.
Now, I've got one of them chill pillows. You know them mat things that get very hot? Have you ever seen them?
A chill pillow.
It's like a gel pillow that keeps you cool during the night.
But like for hippies?
Groovy.
Like a pillow that you chill with?
It's not a hippie thing, no.
Oh, right.
Anyway,
got that wrong.
So he's dropped his spider.
Oh.
And, well, I'm going absolutely raving nuts. I'm trying to get ready for work, ain't I? Anyway, what happens? He goes, well, where is it? And he's picked the pillow up. I goes, it's on the pillow.
No.
Right, so he goes, where? And his wife, I goes, don't mind it about the spider. I'll flame him, run on the floor and we'll never find it. Anyway, he's running across the bed. He's grabbed me chill pillow and whacked it one. Now, me, I have to see the remains.
Yes.
Because I need to know that it's gone.
You need evidence.
Yeah. And I goes, where is it? He goes, it's in the toilet paper. So he's put it in the toilet. I goes, I can't see it. I goes, it ain't in there.
Oh, no.
Well, now I'm wondering, has it got a mate? Because I'm scared to go to bed tonight now.
Yeah, well, it knows where you live, Maxine.
I'm petrified of them.
Yeah.
Now, conkers, you can put conkers.
That won't work. It, a spider that big will eat the conker.
Well, apparently, my friends on Facebook said it's probably eaten every other spider in the house. That's why it's so flaming big. Mm.
It'd be like the alien monster. But the next time you see it, it'll be 6 foot high.
There's got to be something that I can put down tonight.
Well, if you don't mind me saying so, Maxine, your boyfriend is an idiot. Because if it's on the ceiling, you just get a glass. Hey, take that off my screen right now. I mean it. It's a picture of a spider on a conker. God, that's the last thing I need.
He didn't even like the size of the spider. Right. Even he was worried about it.
Right, okay, if it's on the ceiling or anywhere else for that matter, you get a glass and you put it over the spider, and then you slip a bit of paper. Yeah, you don't try to catch it with the jump.
Of course,
yes, I know they do, but you just do it quickly. You just have to be.
This spider, I reckon it could have run in 100-meter hurdles.
Right, you just have to be fast and decisive, Maxine. You got to show it who's boss. Not standing there in your all together screaming your head off. But thanks for that graphic description. Camden, hello, Max.
Hi there. It's a difficult one because I find it splits my sensibilities, because on the one hand, I think the monarchy are very important and they do a great job in lots of ways, all the obvious ways in terms of tourism, and also the Queen is a kind of rock for our sense of the way things should be done, even though we don't always do them ourselves. And the other side is Harry with what he's saying. But what I would like to say about that is that if he's at the end of the interview, I know you didn't say it tonight, but at the end of the interview, he stressed that he was so happy and he had a lovely wife who loved him. He had lovely kids who he adored. And as we know, he's not short of a bob or two. Why is he not being compassionate to the family that he's left and he reckons is sort of dysfunctional?
But don't you think that this is it's almost like a bully in a playground? I mean, the royal family, I find it very hard to believe that they're not feeding stories to the right-wing press. I just find it impossible to believe that's not the case. Yeah. And people say, well, the royal family, they never complain, they never explain. There's this dignified silence. But it's not a dignified silence. They're absolutely yelling through the megaphone that the press have. So it's this constant battering that him and Meghan have been receiving, like a small child in the playground being hit by a bully. Now, when the small child in the playground puts their hands up to defend themselves, then the bully runs to teacher and tells them that he's just been attacked.
Yeah, but they haven't done that, have they? The royal family, they haven't run to the teacher and said we've just been attacked.
The press are doing it on their behalf, is what I'm saying.
Is that how you see it? Yeah, well, maybe, I mean, I'm sort of, like everybody else, I think they're kind of coming to some kind of, it's a little bit overkill in terms of information, I think, for everyone.
Well, that is specifically because of the press. I mean, if you've got the first 9 pages of your newspaper is the Harry story, then
the people guilty of overkill
are the press, not Harry. He's just got a book out. He isn't commandeering the right-wing press in this country, the Express and the Mail and the Telegraph and the Sun and all of those, and forcing them to write about him. That's what they're doing.
Don't you think, though, that he isn't that naive, and neither is she, Megan? I'm not saying they're evil and manipulative, but I'm saying that they are pretty savvy. Well, certainly she is, and he must have been through experience. Don't they realise what's going to happen?
Yes, but my point is that why should they remain silent while the palace is using the press to criticise them loud and long all day?
I take your point, but what I'm saying is they're not being silent now, and they're being less than silent because they're doing all this stuff. The only thing I feel, as I say, the only thing that doesn't quite fit right with me is if it's being told that they are so compassionate and so lovely and all is lovely and they're living in a beautiful world and they're totally happy. Mm. That doesn't sit right with me because I just feel everyone in the royal family are human beings, but Charles is a human being. He's been through a lot. You know, no one talks about that. So, in other words, the one-way ticket emotional. Maybe you're arguing that because they've been through that, they don't care about anybody else.
No, I'm not. No, but I'm just saying, why should they put up with being attacked all day, every day, and not
by the press.
By the press and the palace through the press, and not respond in some way? I mean, he wrote an autobiography. That is, by definition, a tale of your life. But people are criticising him for talking about his life. That's what autobiographies are.
Sure. But a lot... I don't mean to disagree with you, but what I do think is that it went over the top.
Right.
Because, like, so many things that I've had in my case with my family where I regret saying things, they regret saying things, and it's ended up not patching up all it has or whatever. That's life. In other words, you don't feel sorry for yourself for that. You try and get over it.
But could you understand it more if you had, say, had introduced your other half to your family and they had treated them with disrespect?
They did.
Okay. Well, how did that make you feel?
Absolutely appalling, but I had to get over it and realise that I had to be, well, not the bigger man, that's a cliche, but I had to kind of realise that everyone has their own agenda in reality, to be honest, in life. And they have their own perceptions and experience and world and needs and desires and dreams. And that's what causes the conflict. But you can't sort of say it's all their fault.
No, I'm not suggesting that at all. I'm just saying that if one side attacks individuals, then it's surely okay for those individuals to defend themselves at the very least.
I just think he's being a bit emotionally greedy because he's getting so much money for it. That's what I just doesn't sit right.
Okay.
If he was giving half the money to charity, great.
Right. Well, okay. Not sure about that. I mean, pay the royal family something of the order of, what is it, it costs us £300 million a year, something like that, with all the security and so on. So I'm not sure that's an opportune route to go down if we start talking about who earns the most. Oh, God, there is so much about this. All right, if you insist. In his controversial autobiography, Spare, the cheeky Sussex wrote that he had killed some 25 Taliban fighters while serving as a helicopter pilot in Afghanistan. And he did not think of those that he killed as people, but as chess pieces that had to be taken off the board. Well, that makes perfect sense to me. Because if you think of them as people, then you think, well, that's a person who is loved by other people. I mean, they might have a husband or a wife or a boyfriend or a girlfriend. They might have children. They might have grandparents that are depending on them. They'll have, neighbours and friends. And then you might not press that button. It seems blindingly obvious to me. But everybody else is going, pah! Several high-ranking military veterans and experts have also blasted Harry for his comments. The TV that people like this watch, the black-and-white TV channels, are absolutely chock-full of people who used to mark their kills on the side of their planes. Heroes! We make films about them! Penn Farthing, who had been in Afghanistan for the past 18 months of his part of his Operation Ark campaign to rescue animals from shelters in the country, said the badly judged memoir had created grave security concerns for him. In Spare, the prince said that he flew on 6 missions that resulted in the taking of human lives. Well, what the hell else was he out there for? He wasn't the cook. This is the first time that Hazza has specified the number of insurgents he personally killed during his time in Afghanistan. And they're calling it a security fail, as though we were unsure about what it was that we were doing out there. We went there to kill people. That was the point. And then, I think we are through the looking glass here, because the Daily Mail start quoting the Taliban. They're actually having a conversation with the Taliban and siding with them. Is this real life, or am I hallucinating? The Taliban have branded Harry a big-mouth loser after he revealed he killed 25 of their fighters while serving in Afghanistan in his new tell-all memoir. Speaking to the Mail Online, the militants, the Taliban, taunted the Duke of Sussex, who wrote that he viewed their fighters as chess pieces. Have they actually got the phone number of the Taliban on the Daily Mail's Rolodex? Or whatever its current equivalent is? The Taliban claimed, while their fighters are the ultimate victors in the conflict, Harry had fled to his grandmother's palace and is now struggling to maintain a place in the royal family. The Taliban said that. Taliban commander Malavi Agha Gol, 32, said that he thought Harry was attention-seeking and boasted that the chess pieces had taken over the board following the withdrawal of international troops as the militants marched through the country. Well, that's true. That part's true. Yep. That's absolutely true. It's because of the excellent way in which a certain individual organised the withdrawal from his deck chair.
My name's Dominic Raab, and I'm a Tory.
Yeah, I believe you. Speaking from a checkpoint outside the town of Islam Kala on the border with Iran, he said, they've got the number of a checkpoint outside the town of Islam Kala, which is being run by the Taliban. They're probably in the book. Speaking from a checkpoint outside the town, he said, we are still here ruling, but he has fled to his grandmother's palace. He's a big-mouth loser who's been trying to get attention. Does that sound like the Taliban?
No.
Big-mouth loser? I mean, were they speaking in English, or is that translated from the Afghan? Harry, who was known as Captain Wales in the military, wrote that he didn't think of those killed as people, but instead chess pieces he had taken off the board. What doesn't make sense about that? Forward, they cried from the rear, and the front rank died.
Rock and roll!
It's all chess pieces. Holy smoke, they used to actually have a big board in the war room. And women used to push soldiers and battleships around on a big board. It's a game. Particularly to those who are at the back, organising those at the front to run into a fire. He says, Hazza said, you can't kill people if you see them as people. Makes perfect sense. Instead, he saw them as chess pieces to be removed from the board, as bad guys eliminated. Well, who wouldn't do that? Unless you actually really like killing people. An official in the Taliban's Ministry for the Propagation of Virtue and the Prevention of Vice said... I'm not making this up. This is actually quoted in the Daily Mail. They're citing an official in the Taliban's Ministry for the Propagation of Virtue and the Prevention of Vice. They said the pieces of chess are now in power and he's struggling to maintain a place within his own family. God, they speak good English, the Taliban, don't they? Ex-Army Chief Colonel Richard Kemp called Harry's comments ill-judged and said soldiers are not trained to regard their targets as subhuman. He didn't say subhuman. He said not human. God, is anybody paying attention? And you know, James O'Brien, look, you and James O'Brien, he tweeted a story out today, which was helpful. Appreciate it, James.
Thank you.
And I'll come to that in just a minute, in the very same blooming newspaper. I mean, it's not like, you know, they have standards that differ between people that they do and do not like. It's just that they have standards that differ between people that they do and do not like. Okay, here's the... I've got the passage in the book that Harry wrote about this, about, you know, killing 25 people. Now, you have probably only read what the offshore billionaire-owned tax-avoiding media have written about it. But I've got the actual passage. So I'll tell you about that in a minute. But first, you just heard me yakking on about what the Mail was actually siding with the Taliban, it seems. How they have their number, nobody knows. Maybe that you can Google them. I wonder if people rate them. Everybody dead, 5 stars. Right, this is the Mail from 2016, which was tweeted out by James O'Brien today. Okay, Mail from 2016, headline, I shot a man who was 1.5 miles away and it took 6 seconds to learn if I hit him, British sniper recalls. Accompanied by a picture of a bloke lying in the grass looking heroic. A record-breaking British Army sniper who killed Taliban insurgents from more than 1.5 miles away has revealed it took 6 seconds to find out if his hit was successful. In November 2009, Sergeant Craig Harrison recorded the longest confirmed kill ever made when he shot 2 militant assassins from a range of 2,475 metres, more than 900 metres beyond his rifle's effective range. The sniper made history with the shots he fired in Helmand province in Afghanistan. He calculated it would take 6 seconds for a bullet to even reach the Taliban gunner, manning the weapon and his lookout, despite travelling at supersonic speeds. And then there's just, like, detail about how they do that sort of thing. It's all about the wind and the, you know, rays of the sun and all that sort of stuff. It was only later when an Apache helicopter measured the distance of the miracle shots. Miracle shots! 24 football pitches away, that Sergeant Harrison realised he was the holder of a macabre world record. He says, as a sniper, there's an inner freeze when you shoot someone. It's as if time has slowed down and all your senses are heightened. There's also an excitement that all snipers know and love, like a drug coursing through the veins. I'm no psycho nor a butcher. I don't crave the killing. I just love the exultation of a job well done. Can you spot the difference in the coverage? A little bit. He was acclaimed as a hero, but an error by military chiefs led to his name being released. God. He developed post-traumatic stress disorder and was denied the military cross for his bravery. His colonel refused it on his behalf, thinking he would not have been able to handle the pressure. Sergeant Harrison was dumbfounded by the decision. Well, colour me dumbfounded by everything that I've read today. Here's the passage in Hazard's book. Quotes, Afghanistan was a war of mistakes, a war of enormous collateral damage, thousands of innocents killed and maimed, and that always haunted us. So my goal was from the day I arrived was never to go to bed doubting that I had done the right thing, that my targets had been correct, that I was firing on Taliban and only Taliban, no civilians nearby. I wanted to return to Britain with all my limbs, but more, I wanted to go home with my conscience intact, which meant being aware of what I was doing and why I was doing it at all times. Most soldiers can't tell you precisely how much death is on their ledger. In battle conditions, there's often a great deal of indiscriminate firing. But in the age of Apaches and laptops, everything I did in the course of 2 combat tours was recorded and time-stamped. I could always say precisely how many enemy combatants I'd killed. And I felt it vital never to shy away from that number. Among the many things I learned in the army, accountability was near the top of the list. So, my number... 25. It wasn't a number that gave me any great satisfaction, but neither was it a number that made me feel ashamed. Naturally, I'd have preferred not to have that number on my military CV, on my mind, but, by the same token, I preferred to live in a world in which there was no Taliban, a world without war. Even for an occasional practitioner of magical thinking like me, however, some realities just can't be changed. While in the heat and fog of combat, I didn't think those 25 as people. You can't kill people if you think of them as people. You can't really harm people if you think of them as people. They were chess pieces removed from the board. Bads taken away before they could kill goods. I'd been trained to otherize them. Trained well. On some level, I recognise this learned detachment as problematic, but I also saw it as an unavoidable part of soldiering. Another reality that couldn't be changed. What's wrong with that? Well, the press managed to find a way. Top 20 things that are wrong with that. No one is interested in Prince Harry anymore. Full details on pages 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and 14. Greenford, local.
Hello, Nick. Yeah, I think I'm on Harry's side, but I think he learnt all these media skills from his mother, who went also through this sort of media circus. But I think what it is I think his book and his interview on ITV Today and CBS and Netflix, I think it's added to his CV. I think he's quite a contender for, you know, he's fighting his corner. But it might just be a healthy critique of the monarchy, you know, both sides being answered in the media. I don't know.
All right. Thanks, Charles. Paul, let's have a call in Nottingham. Hello, James.
Oh, hello.
An ecstasy of fumbling. Hello.
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 Yes, hello.
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 Yes.
Hello.
Mm-hmm.
Hi, Nick. I'm a big fan.
Thanks.
Yeah, sometimes you're a bit repetitive.
Repetitive, and, over and over and over again. It's like doing a show in Switzerland. Everywhere is just echoes.
And you're consciously woke.
Consciously woke? Woke?
Yeah,
what does woke mean?
Well, it means just being ridiculously...
It doesn't.
...oversensitive about all sorts of things.
No, it doesn't.
You could work that out.
It doesn't. But go on.
I'm consciously
oversensitive. Okay.
Yes.
Now you're about to accuse me of not being sensitive enough. Go ahead.
I don't care. What's wrong with not knowing whether you support a strike or not?
Just pick one. Do you or don't you?
No, but there's absolutely nothing wrong with being in two minds. It's a human condition.
The human condition. People make a decision, a snap decision about almost everything.
No, they don't.
It's a survival mechanism.
I don't.
Of course you do.
You just made one right now.
Exactly.
People are more complex than you realize. They're not sure.
Give me an instant response. If your life depended on it, you would be able to give me an instant response.
I'm not talking about whether my life depends upon it regarding a rail strike.
Right. Do you support them or don't you?
That's a false analogy.
Do you support them or don't you? Yes?
I don't know.
Oh, my God. How long does it take for you to...
Are you a mathematician working in binary numbers?
Everybody makes decisions about everything in an instant, whether they realise it or not. People pass you in the street. You make an instant decision about who they are, principally for your own survival. You put somebody in a pigeonhole immediately. Is this person a threat or not? For instance... You listen to a piece of music, you know, whether you like it or you don't, within about 2 seconds of it starting. You have a mouthful of food, you know, whether you like it or you don't, before you've actually swallowed the thing. Everybody's making instant decisions all of the time. How long does it take for you to make an instant decision, James?
Jeans.
What?
I'm not sure whether I like Berlioz or not.
Berlioz?
Yeah.
Is that a biscuit? Mmm. Berlioz. I like them crumbled up into ice cream. So yummy. Anyway, thanks a lot, James. Seems a bit shouty to me. Richmond, Kieran.
Hello, yeah, hi. How you doing?
Good, thanks.
Very good. Excellent.
Yes, Kieran, what would you like to say?
Yes, well, in my personal opinion, I believe... I mean, I'm a journalist. I used to write for the Daily Express and the Daily Sport.
Oh.
I personally believe, in my opinion, the British press... are very brutal, but also at the same time, we have our opinion. And Harry and Meghan, how do I say this? They put the issues on themselves, and they make, how do I say it? People say that, you know, they've stabbed the royal family in the back, but I don't personally believe they stabbed the family. I believe, you know, I'm on the fence. They want to live their life, and if they choose... not to be a royal family member and continue their lives as a married couple and continue having a family, I think we should support them.
Do you think that that people have decided that you can either be a member of the royal family or not exist in the public eye at all.
Sorry, say that again. Sorry, what were you saying?
What I'm suggesting is that the public seems to have decided, correct me if I'm wrong, that you can either be a working member of the royal family or you must disappear forever.
Right. I mean, in my opinion, I think Prince Harry, as you know, he was born into the royal family. Meghan Markle married into the royal family. Now, if Meghan has decided that she wants to, you know, go back into her normal life and continue because, you know, continue her normal life prior and, you know, how do I say, is leave the royal family, then it's up to her as herself. But if Prince Harry has decided to follow her, that's his responsibility. That's his decision. And I think we need to respect that. That's my personal opinion.
But do you think that the press have the sort of coverage that they're getting from the press, is it because the press have become irked that they haven't led their life in the way that the press wanted them to for, you know, maximum profitability, because that's what it's all about, isn't it, the money, that they haven't, they've refused to live their life according to the script that had been written for them?
Well, yes, but the thing is, like I said before, everybody has a decision. Everybody has, you know, their reason. Now, I understand Meghan married into the family, into the royal family. She knew what she was doing. But as a woman at her age, and if she realized that it wasn't right for her, you know, she could have gone her own way. She could have said, you know, you continue your royal duties, Harry, and I'll go back to America. And they could have still been married, but had it in a separate.
Six 6,000 miles away.
Well, I mean, it's up to them. You know, remember one thing, you know, people have relationships, distant relationships all over the world. It's just the fact that we are scrutinizing Meghan Markle, mainly because she is, number one, very, very famous, but also, number two, she married Prince Harry. Mm. Now, am I going to say people are biased because Prince Harry's English? He's British, sorry. Yes, absolutely. We are very biased because we're British. We, you know, I've asked some people in the past. I've interviewed lots of kind of political people and celebrities, and they all say that because Prince Harry, you know, he belongs to us. This is what they say, he belongs to us. But right. Prince Harry is, how do I say this? If he decides that he wants to follow Meghan Markle, that's entirely up to him.
Well, he would, though, because she's his wife. Exactly.
Yes.
On this subject, I mean, I was talking to the reporter just a moment ago, and you say you used to work for the Express and the Sport.
Yes, I did.
What about this idea that Harry and Meghan are just responding not to the royal family directly, but they're responding to the stories that have been placed by the royal family in the newspapers? How much of a connection does the royal family have with the newspapers, and can they say, here's a story, print this?
Well, it depends on the Buckingham Palace press office. You know, the PR people, it depends on them. You know, they correspond with us journalists all the time and the news editors. You know, it's up to us what we publish. But I'm sure, you know, the Buckingham Palace press office, they have their connections. But, you know, if we're talking not just newspapers, we're talking about the documentary on the Netflix. Now, I'm not on their side on that. That I have to disagree. You know, them slaughtering the royal family, etc. You know, it's not right. That's not right. You know, Prince Harry, you know, shouldn't have done that. And that is wrong. That's wrong. But from a personal point of view, if we're going back to, you know, Prince Harry having his own decision in moving to America, that's up to him. But the Netflix documentary was awful. It was awful. Well, you know, you don't slag your own family off on social media. You wouldn't do that to your mum. So why are you doing that to, you know, why are you making a documentary about...
Well, only because, and I go back to my point, he is answering not the royal family themselves, but he's answering the press, who are the conduit for the stories that he is responding to. That's what I'm suggesting, is that the royal family say, well, we never comment, no explanation, no complaint, no... whatever, I can't remember. Anyway, they don't speak directly about these sort of things, but they get the right-wing press to speak on their behalf, and that's what he's answering.
Well, yes, you're right, but like I say, you know, they have their agents. They have their PR people for that. Now, if Prince Harry wanted to speak directly on social media, then you would get the honest truth. We don't know what the PR people will only, in my personal opinion, press people will only tell you what you want to hear. You know, when you get press releases, it's what they want to put out. Mm. Now, if they respond on a comment, for instance, they want to respond on a comment on a particular article. They want to respond on a comment on a different article, and they say, "Well, that we don't agree with that, or we disagree with that." Then you know, that's up to the press office. But yeah, that's my opinion. I mean, okay. Yeah, I just want to give you my opinion. I think Prince Harry has a right in to do what he wants, but the documentary was awful. It was really awful because I wouldn't do that to my family.
So, all right, okay, yeah. Good to talk to you, Kieran. Thanks for that, Brighton. Hello, John.
Hello, Nick. Yeah, I mean, John. It's all crazy, isn't it? Yeah. This Harry and Meghan royal family saga.
It's just a family. Well, it's like every other family. It's a completely dysfunctional family, just like every other family.
Well, it is like every other family.
More so, perhaps.
But it's all being played out in public.
Yeah.
So, it's not quite the same. But no,
any celebrity family. I mean, they're all celebrities. People want to write about them all the time because it's a soap opera. That's why people are interested.
Yeah. Yeah. But yeah, but then you've got King Charles, the new king, and which isn't quite the norm anyway. But no, I wanted to say, I hope Harry and Meghan are not going to come to the coronation because the country will go into meltdown. I don't know if we're going to be able to survive it.
No, I think the Mail, the Express and the Telegraph will go into meltdown. Ordinary people will probably not be that bothered. They'll watch it on TV and they might tut a bit or comment on what they're wearing, I would guess.
Yeah. Well, but everyone gets sucked into it in different ways. And I feel a bit sorry for King Charles, though, with all this. You know, just starting his reign and he's got all this going on.
Yeah. What with that whole pen thing? Everything, yeah. Dreadful.
And the thing is, I think in the end, there's no way this is ever going to get resolved, is it? You can't. I don't think there's ever any way that this. The disagreement between Harry, Meghan and the royal family is ever going to get resolved. This is going to be a family at war forever, isn't it?
Well, at war is a bit strong. They moved, they left the country. They're not going to be at war. They're just not going to be seeing each other over the dinner table anytime soon.
Yeah, but I mean, obviously now with this book, this is exploding onto the scene. Then you've got if Harry and Meghan go to the coronation, I mean, Are they going to produce a new book or a new Netflix series off that? Is that going to explode onto the scene?
I mean, it's like, I've got no idea. The bloke wrote a book about himself. Every library in the world has got must have 10% of what's on the shelves as people writing about themselves.
Yeah,
autobiographies are a thing.
Yeah, but nobody would ever invite, anybody that was behaving like that to their wedding or their coronation, would they? Normally, well, obviously, King Charles maybe has to, really, because he's his son. So, impossible situation, really. Yeah,
not really. It's just a family. They don't get on. So what? Crying out loud. They left already. But we're trying to drag them back just so we can beat them up. St. Albans. Hello, David.
Hello there, Nick. I just heard you talking to that chap about AI.
Yes.
And my daughter sent off some of her photographs, and they sent back these images, and they are absolutely stunning. Mm. She's a very attractive girl, but the pictures they made of her were just brilliant. They're all done in different styles, and it was incredible. And you know, they're good enough to put on the wall.
Well, you know, anything is good enough to put on a wall. People put their 5-year-old child's pictures on a wall.
No, well, anyway, if you saw the pictures, you would believe me. Also,
but I would question whether that was art. I mean, it might be reproduction, but it's not art, I would suggest.
It looks like art because it's done in a paint-type style.
A painterly way, yeah. But it's been programmed to do that. So it's not making this stuff up which is what I would call art.
But what she did do, send me another AI program, and what you do, you type a little sentence, and she said, you can think of anything you like.
Mm.
So I thought, I know, how about a spaceman, an astronaut, sitting in a deck chair on the moon? And within a few seconds, it had generated four different images with that scenario.
Right.
And they just looked incredibly amazing.
Also, not art. It's just it's like a copying machine. It's a fancy copying machine. I just don't call that art.
It stitches it all together.
Yeah, I'm sure. That's just great. Not art. But, not for me.
That's computer art.
No, not you. I don't think you have. I don't think computers are capable of art. I just don't think so. I think art has to have that human element. It just does. I mean, any more than a trained elephant in Thailand, which has been trained to hold a brush in its trunk and wave it at canvases. That's not art either. It doesn't know what it's doing. It's not thinking of its position on a gallery wall. It's just waving a paintbrush because otherwise it doesn't get fed. Let's have Bodmin. Hello, Malcolm.
Hello, Nick. How are you, mate?
Good, thanks.
Couple of things, minimum. Starmer, Sunak, and Prince Harry.
What does that mean? Are you giving me a choice?
Prince Harry is on every newspaper in the land. Mm. What does he think that's going to do for him? Sell books? I don't know. And they're all getting sucked in. Nicky's playing an absolute blinder. I mean, just very quickly, and not a major point, the thing about the number of people they're saying he killed, he was on an Apache helicopter, which if they were there. If you could analyse the sorties that they do, they're flying out to rescue or to take out the people who are threatening British and Allied forces who are already at the scene of whatever's happening. So that's what he was doing. He went in to provide air cover. That was his role, Nick.
Right.
And Sunak and Starmer, you got Starmer literally trolling. Well, the British version of rednecks, and
he's trolling rednecks. What do you mean by that? Trolling rednecks.
Well, for me, you've got Trump and the dingalings.
Yeah.
And I was going to mention that you've got to find a piece of music for the British equivalent of redneck, green sleeves or something. You'll have to get a clip of
green sleeves. No.
Or Rule Britannia, maybe something like that.
Oh, well, yeah. Maybe not. Like something like that.
Yeah. But it's an absolute work of art. Him holding or making a speech where he is literally stealing the slogans of Leave, and he's actually making it work. He will make it work. He will take back the control, hopefully, Nick.
Who are we talking about? I'm kind of lost. Who are we talking about
Starmer,
now? Starmer. Right.
With his speech and the quote that he wants to take back control.
Did he? I didn't see his speech. I didn't see Fishy Sunak's speech. I'm woefully underprepared for this show.
No, they're worth watching to compare and contrast, I think.
I bet there's not much difference between the two. I bet you can put a Rizzler between the two of them. Keir Starmer seems to be virtually hugging the Conservative Party. He couldn't get any closer. If he got any closer, he'd be squeezed out through the other side of him.
No, I think on the Brexit issue, I'm starting to see where he's coming from, I think. And he's not winding anybody up, Nick. That's first and foremost.
Well, I don't know. He's winding the Remoners up, people who know that this, who actually can, read and see and know that Brexit's not working. He's winding them up, which is the majority of the population. It's getting on for 60%.
Well, no, but the point there, Nick, is he knows, I know, you know, there's not going to be another referendum.
No, neither should there be. We should just go back in. Somebody should make a decision.
But that's the plan, Nick. And there won't be a decision that any of us will know about. It'll simply happen with deals and
yeah,
and
they'll call it a trade deal.
Yeah, well, yeah, yeah. But then you could move on to Sunak with his maths thing.
Mm.
I mean, it's they reckon after the next election, maybe by 2030, but even if he could do it now, who's he going to wind up? He's going to wind up a whole generation of youngsters.
And their teachers. I mean, can you imagine how difficult it's going to be for a teacher standing in front of 30 kids, 27 of whom don't want to be there?
Well, and loads of people have said this week that we don't have enough school teachers.
Well, yeah,
But the thing is, Nick, there aren't enough math school teachers now to teach math up to 16 anyway. I mean, the school I was in, we probably had about eight math teachers, one of whom had a degree in math. And many a time I was called in to teach science, not simply to cover, you know, the free lessons of other colleagues, but to actually teach it. And there's a huge amount of that has happened since I left, and that was quite a few years ago. So it's just another soundbite, Nick, I think, and a way to go.
It's just such a weird soundbite. I mean, who's going to stand up and clap for that? More maths lessons. It's just such a bizarre thing to say.
Well, loads of people in the job, Nick, realise that far too many people are leaving school without the numeracy skills that they need.
Yeah, I get that.
Numeracy skills aren't maths.
Correct. Numeracy skills are something you learn up to maybe 14, 16 years old. Not advanced mathematics, which is for people who have a predilection in that area.
No, but there are plenty of kids, Nick, who stay in school because there's nothing else for them, who would benefit, and I'm no Tory, but they would benefit from more numeracy, which is applied maths, if you like,
yes.
But not maths.
Right,
but we're
talking basics, being able to add up a column of figures, that kind of thing. You don't need cosines and all that stuff. I've got no idea, because I don't need maths. I've never needed advanced mathematics, because that's not remotely where I work.
Well, keep it even simpler than that, Nick. It could be the sorts of skills that you're going to need working in a warehouse, a park store, a supermarket. You know, there's all sorts of ways of teaching kids maths, which is relevant to life, isn't it?
But it's not relevant to any of those things. If you're working in a supermarket, the machine does it for you. Working in a bar as well. Nobody can add up two pints in a bar. They have to turn and go to the machine and press the button that's got a picture of the pint that they've just drawn. And then the machine tells them how much it, they don't even see how much it is. They just proffer the credit card thing and you wave your card over it and no maths is involved.
No, there's numeracy skills behind all of those things, Nick. It isn't simply a person walking in, putting in their staff number, and they're in charge of a till. There's numeracy all around places, isn't there?
No.
Other than hitting electronic devices, I think. Anyway, building sites, factories.
I'm not decrying the importance of mathematics. It's extremely important, but you cannot force people who don't have a mathematical bent to study that subject until they're 18 and actually take on board any information that's going to help in their career or in their life. I mean, maths is multiplication, adding, subtracting, dividing.
Yes.
That's it, pretty much. Other than that, percentages, other than that, you don't really need to know anything unless you're going to go into, you know, computing or accountancy or architecture or, you know, one of those things.
I don't agree, Nick. There's numeracy skills which are nothing to do with computers and things like that. All sorts of problem solving, Nick, relies on basic math, arithmetic.
Yeah, we're not at odds here, Malcolm. I'm saying a basic grounding in maths is advantageous, but not to study it to 18. You can pick it up, but when you're 14, all you need.
You're right. We're as one. But the point I'm making is it's applied math but not applied maths. It's applied numeracy for things that and people do when they leave school, I think. It's not maths, Nick, in the true sense of the word, which I think is what Rishi is speaking of. So, yeah.
Right. He's talking about advanced mathematics, which is something that you need to have. And, you know, you need to have that kind of a brain that's going to suck that information up. Otherwise, it just bounces off kids. They just don't care.
No. Well, in fairness, Dick, he, and again, I'm not the first person that's defensive on that, but he spoke the other night, and in fairness to him, he did say that it's maths of thought, yeah? It's not the mathematics like an O-level AS and then A-level. He's saying maths, which might be of use, I suspect.
Up to 18 years of age. I mean, you start at... I mean, when do you start learning maths at school? When you're, like, five? So, like, proper maths, let's say 12, 13. You don't need to learn basic maths until you're 18. Nobody needs that much adding and subtracting. I mean, after you've taught kids how to add and subtract when they're 12, what are you going to do for the next 6 years? Just tell them to do it again? It's just absolute nonsense. I mean, that he said it out loud is just absolutely incredible. Is there nobody there to, you know, rein him in a bit? Maybe he should pass his genius ideas by someone who is, you know, has some grasp on reality. Because he ain't got none in that perfumed cloud of loveliness that he lives in. Our precious little princeling, Bermondsey. Hello, Lavinia Grace.
Oh, hi, Nick. How are you?
I'm great, mate.
Oh, that's good. Anyway, I would like to talk about what is going on, Nick.
Yes.
And, you know, as I said earlier, it saddens me terribly because I initially believe that the government has lost its moral compass on every level.
This government couldn't find its moral compass with a sat nav.
You know,
are you watching television right now?
Sorry, no, I'm not.
Is that a yes?
No.
When you say no, are you saying yes?
No. No, I'm in the kitchen right now, Nick.
Well, that doesn't mean that you're not watching television. I mean, some people have got TV in the kitchen. Have you got TV on in the living room? Really, really loud.
So, well, hold on a moment,
See?
Nick.
Take all the time you need. It's a live show.
Hold on.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Not much ready.
I'm going to hang up the moment she gets back to the phone.
Sorry, Nick. Hello, Nick.
Ah, I'm afraid that's all we've got time for, Lavinia.
Oh, I'm so sorry, Nick.
No, that's okay. All right, better luck next time.
Oh, Happy New Year, my lovely.
Yeah, Happy New Year. Cheers, my dear. Another satisfied customer. Belfast, Brendan.
Hello, Happy New Year, and thank you very much for taking... Sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just saying Happy New Year, Brendan.
Yeah, pretty cool. Sometimes the radio is just as good as it ever was, and this is it. Anyway, I have an I, an N, and then at the end a question, if that's okay.
Okay, then.
Okay, the I is identity cards, voter identity cards.
I know, shocking.
Well, any reasonable person, including me, would think that this was a deliberate attempt to disenfranchise people who can't be bothered.
Yes.
Or are in some way unable to go to a place to get ID.
Just putting any impediment up against people that might not vote for your party is worth it if even just one person doesn't go, because that might be something that swings an election. So that's what I believe that is all about. It's also what would Donald Trump do?
Oh, shut up!
The worst thing in any given situation. Yeah.
Yes. Well, I would have agreed with you, but now... from my own personal experience in life here in Northern Ireland, or the north of Ireland, whatever you want to refer it to it as, voter registration ID became mandatory here in about the late 80s.
Right.
It
doesn't really matter. Let's not get into that. It's just a way of putting up any kind of impediment.
It's absolutely not.
It's solving a problem that doesn't exist. There is no widespread fraud in our elections. But I can't get into that now, Brendan, because I'm not doing that. We're doing this. So what else you got?
Okay. Now I'll go for P. It's the word that you're not allowed to... I need to just say one sentence on that last thing.
Go on.
Voter ID was a bad thing, but it became a good thing because it means that everybody that gets voter ID and goes out and votes contains things. That's what we learned.
Well, it's got nothing to do with voter ID. You can vote and change things. It's completely irrelevant. But like I said, I'm not doing that now. We're doing this. Middlesbrough, Stephen.
Hi, yes, Stephen.
Stephen.
Yes, Stephen, right here.
Yes, sir.
I think from across the board as the working class man, it's an absolute joke. You know, Meghan and Harry being absolutely slandered across the board, but we've got to look at the royal family as a whole. I mean, we absolutely love the royal family, but at the end of the day, you know, those two are getting absolutely slandered for everything. But, you know, we've got to look at the facts. It's rotten from the core, the royal family, it is. You know, we love them. We love Diana. We love the Queen. We love them all. But, you know, we've got to look at it. We've got to look at it.
Right. I see. I'm not sure that we love all of them. We certainly felt great affection for the Queen and Diana. And after that, I think people have different views. Harrow. Harrow. Jonathan.
Nick, hello.
Yes, sir.
I have a few things weighing on my mind, you say. A
couple of three things.
Well, just on the quick on the Harry point, he does. It's not my main point, but he's a young boy who has been corrupted by the Meghan Markle.
Not really. Not very young. He's about 42 years old already.
He is losing sympathy from the British people.
Oh, please.
Now, he's losing sympathy. People don't love him anymore.
Sure they do. They just blame her for everything.
But the main thing is that I want to apologise to you.
You want to apologise to me?
Because
You don't have to tell me why. You can just apologise. I will accept your apology with good grace.
No, but I need to tell you. It's important.
I prefer that you didn't tell me what it was you were apologising about, that you just said sorry. And I want you to think... Jonathan, I want you to think about what you've done.
Okay, but the thing is, you are one of the few people who are sticking up for the Corbyn.
Sticking up for the Corbyn.
And I believe all of the lies about him. And now I look at this country. I was Googling Trump today, and apparently he's conned a lot of people.
You were Googling Trump?
Disgusting.
Is that as bad as it sounds?
Listen to me. It's a serious point. I was in the Holiday in Calcutta.
Yes.
And when I was being driven out of the Calcutta, it was even he's got a Trump Tower there. And that's got lots of controversy as well. So the problem is that you are one of the few people who are talking against the Brexit Trump, and you are saying Corbyn is a good man.
Well, I don't believe I ever said Corbyn was a good man. Those words did not exit my mouth. But just don't pile on like the billionaire-owned offshore British press barons do.
No, but by not saying he was a bad man, you were making a point.
Right.
I think.
I was actually saying that I was in love with him. Is that what you mean?
But are you now scared to say you are? Because I just want to say this country now...
I'd like to suck the soup out of his beard. Is that what you mean?
Now, listen, this country is in such a bad situation, and I was going to say that it's... Oh, there are me, Corbyn. I'm so sorry, I didn't trust him.
There's three listeners with material in a row on the Nicky Abbott show. And he hung up on himself. Which means that I don't have to. It's a dream come true. Hey, Melania, somebody's been Googling your husband.
I don't care.
She's not that bothered. Brixton, John.
Hello.
Yes, John.
Now, my mum actually worked in South London Women's Hospital.
Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually saw her go to work every day, and then she came back and she told us her experience of what she actually done. Now, our Prime Minister has had no experience at all of actually being a patient within the NHS.
No.
He hasn't.
I agree.
He can admit that.
Well, he can't. He won't admit it.
No, but he can admit it because he has had the money to go private.
Yes.
So, therefore, we all know that he's lying.
Well, he's not lying. Like, he's refusing to say. Which is kind of a ridiculous pose on his part, because everybody knows what the answer to the question, have you ever availed yourself of the NHS? Of course it's no.
So, therefore, right, now he can be my younger brother because he does look a bit like me, right? Like, we do look alike, but we were brought up on different sides of the streets. He was brought up on the rich side, while I was brought up in Brixton on the poor side.
Yes.
Now, if we were to meet up in a cafe, and I was asking the question, man to man, have you ever gone private?
Right, what we've already dealt with that. He's been asked whether he's gone private, and he refused to say. He said it's an irrelevance. But, of course, it's not an irrelevance, because if you have no experience of something, then you should find it hard to talk about it. His experience of medical treatment is to get seen straight away in a comfortable, warm environment. Milton Keynes. Hello, Caroline.
Hello there. How are you?
Good, thanks.
All right. Yeah. Yeah, what it is that I think Harry and Meghan are great.
Right.
Yeah.
But you've heard and read a lot of stories that say the opposite, so you're resisting that.
Yeah. Stick around, it gets better, you know.
Okay, I'm not sure what that means, but thanks for that, Caroline.
Oh, hi there. Is that Nick?
Yes, Jack.
Nick, first of all, I've literally just been rehearsing in my head because I thought, oh, my God, I'm going to be sat here for hours. my dad is a huge fan of you, and he advised me to listen to you on a weekend, and thank God, because I think you're brilliant.
Well, thanks. Thanks, Jack, and thanks, Dad. Thanks, Jack's dad.
He's called Kev. He's absolutely fantastic, and he thinks you're brilliant, and I do too, actually.
Wow.
But I initially rang. I know you don't want to hear this, but initially you rang about all the Harry stuff. But after the conversation's gone on, Jesus Christ, it's God. I've started writing down a list, and I'm thinking, God, it's such a long list now. But what I did want to say initially, in relation to Harry, is that, God, that boy...
Stop saying needs, God.
That boy needs someone around him who genuinely loves him.
Well, I think he's got that, don't he?
I've got to be honest, if it was my husband, I don't think I'd, you know, say, oh, yeah, go on, do that, say that, blah, blah, blah. You know, it's a family thing, and if you've got beef in your family, you deal with it in the family. Don't
right, unless that family is not speaking from their own mouths, but using the entire edifice of the British establishment to speak on their behalf. He's not just shouting into a void. He's shouting back at a giant 100-mile-high tsunami of ire that is coming his way from the British establishment.
Yeah, I totally get that. But it seems like what's came out is a lot more beef than what's actually, you know, there's a lot more to the story.
Yeah.
A hell of a lot more to the story.
Well, and that makes it interesting, I suppose. I mean, he's selling a book, and job done, I reckon.
He's selling a book. It seems to me that he's putting himself out there. He's in a very vulnerable position.
Oh, please.
Vulnerable? I think he's in a very vulnerable position.
Well, what does that mean?
Nobody around him
who truly loves him. He's got a wife. He's got a wife, Jack. What are you talking about? You think his wife doesn't love him?
Genuinely advise him and say, that's not a good idea.
Well, maybe it is a good idea. He's going to make hundreds of millions of dollars.
But it's not about money, is it?
Of course it is. He wrote a book for money. He wrote the podcast, or she's doing the podcast for money. They've got a Netflix documentary
that's
for
it.
Money.
That's it. Has he done that? Because he doesn't need money, does he?
Everybody needs money. Their lifestyle is such that they're going to need a massive amount of cash pouring in.
He doesn't need it anyway. But anyway, I don't want to get too beefy that, because I will just, you know. And then I was thinking about, you know, this story about, you know, he'd spoke about people who he'd killed in Afghanistan and things like that. And it shouldn't be spoke of.
Why not?
You know, like, in one way I get it, but another way I don't, because everyone talks about mental health and, you know, how we should be kind and things like that. But, you know,
Not be kind. Talk about your feelings. Not be
exactly.
kind.
Exactly.
Being you kind know, is a separate people. Issue entirely. That's exactly what he's doing. He's talking about the experience that he went through. He's unburdening himself. But no, we would prefer that you bottled it up. Unless you're somebody else, in which case you can brag about the number of Taliban that you killed, and the newspapers will probably put you on the front page with a Union Jack behind you and call you a hero. Walthamstow. Hello, Mark.
Nick.
Mark.
Can you hear me?
Sounds like you've got your head in a bucket.
I have.
It's not that bad, mate.
There's a hole in my bucket, dear Liza.
More listeners with material. What have I done to deserve this?
Nick!
What are you doing? What are you doing, Mark?
This thing about Harry killing 25...
Mark, what are you doing right now?
Never you mind.
Okay, well, whatever it is, stop doing it right now. Greenford, hello, Paul.
Hello, Nick. Yeah, I think like the government and monarchy have made so many mistakes that, I don't know, what
the
are
monarchy?
We going to do? It's just crazy.
The monarchy?
Yeah, the monarchy have made loads of mistakes.
Anybody in particular?
Harry has shown his best to redeem a kind of extravagant lifestyle, and he's tried to put it down on paper, and he succeeded in doing his message.
Right, and selling a boatload of books in the process, making millions of dollars. For him and his publishers, they can't believe their luck, because this time of year is a pretty thin period for book buying, because, you know, everybody gives each other books for Christmas.
Boring.
Worst present ever, and they don't buy books in January much, apart from if it's Hazza out of Hazza and Sparkles.
Yeah, I know. It's funny, isn't it? But I think, like, Rishi Sunak, he's lasted longer than, who was it, the last one?
Exactly. Who was the last one?
Absolutely.
Yeah, we've got no idea. We'll think hard and try to come up with a name. Weybridge. Hello, Ray.
Hello, Nick. Good evening.
Ray.
How are you doing tonight?
Good, thanks.
Good. A couple of things. On a very serious note, I know your show is... informative and comical at the same time. Math is important because it takes you out of poverty if you know it. But the previous caller, you had a caller before the break, said the way he said it, just math, in a plain vanilla way, it's not going to make sense to even the kids, let alone the teachers.
Hang on a minute. Can I just stop you there? Because you said that maths takes you out of poverty if you know it. That can only be true if A, you're good at maths, and B, you get lucky. I mean, some people are taken out of poverty by being good at football, or boxing, or writing, or painting.
There's many ways out of
or
poverty.
Dancing.
There's many ways out. Yeah. There's many ways out of poverty. You're right. I was talking about something specific that I know about. I know two kids that were born in New Cross, live in a council flat. They're in their 20s now. They earn six figures. One works for a big tech company, and the other works for J.P. Morgan.
Right.
Just because.
No doubt.
No, they forced themselves, they went to tutorship, they learned, and they perfected it. And that's
you're
the
only,
way for the future.
Yes, but you're only talking about those two people, because the other 10,000 people who had a similar experience didn't go to J.P. Morgan and aren't earning six figures. It's like when people say, you know, if you really work hard, then you'll become a billionaire like me. Look at me, I worked hard and I'm a billionaire, so you can do it too. No, you can't. It's like winning the lottery.
Okay, another point I want to make is languages. For anybody out there that's listening, you've got children, because you know, my kids go to school, and I remember when we went to secondary school, and they said, he has a choice of Latin, French, Spanish, or Mandarin.
Right.
And I said, Mandarin all day long, because that's where we're going. You have to just move with the trends. You know, these kids are playing, like you said, they're playing with Instagram and Facebook and whatever. It's all based on maths. So if they want to know what's behind that, they need to understand mathematics. Basically.
Unfortunately, I kind of agree with what you're saying, but we're talking about the skills that are required at this moment. But the children aren't going to be presenting themselves to the job market at this moment. They're going to be doing it in 10 or 15 years' time. And in 10 or 15 years' time, you might not need languages, because there is, at this moment, I can speak into my phone and it can tell me, it can read back in perfect Mandarin what it is that I just said to it. Same with maths. I mean, people have calculators now. I mean, who knows, in the future, nobody might need to know anything about maths. And it might be, actually, the only thing that you can not get a robot to do is the arts. I mean, you can program a robot from now until the end of time. It will not come up with a back catalogue like the Rolling Stones. It just won't. It will not produce Dark Side of the Moon. You know that. It can't be done, ever. It can't be funny. It won't be able to tell you a joke, because it won't be able to have timing. I mean, they can fine-tune these things. I mean, I know they've got the chatbot at the moment, and it seems real-ish, but not real. So we might not need to know any of the things that they're teaching us at school. We might be being dragged down the wrong way entirely. I mean, who knows? In the future, you might not actually need to be able to operate a mouse or a keyboard, or you won't be looking at a screen. I mean, the tech world is charging ahead at triple speed, much faster than any other avenue of industry. So it seems a bit presumptuous, really, to tell people at a very, very young age that you should learn this because this will get you this job, the job that currently exists. But they're not after the job that currently exists. They're going to be after the one that exists in 15 years' time. Fulham. Wendy.
Oh, hello.
Wendy.
Hi, Les. I was... different subjects, I know, but there's a mouse in my oven.
There's a mouse... where?
In my cooker, in my oven.
On the stove. Right there. A little mouse with...
So I got two cats.
You got two cats? Well, they should have taken care of that, no?
Well, I have to open the oven, don't I?
Yes.
So it comes out.
Right.
And then...
And then the cats will torture it for about 3 hours before leaving it there.
Now I've come to the conclusion, let that happen. Because, you know, I'm sitting over here and I'm thinking, I'm sure I heard something in the kitchen.
Wendy,
it's
not a cheap solution, but I think if you turned the oven on, then the mouse problem would disappear.
I've put it on.
Yes.
I have done that, and then, you know, just sort of come away. But then I turn it off, and there's no sign.
There's no sign. No, there's probably a hole in the back of your oven, which seems dangerous, actually.
What, for me?
No, it's not a human-sized hole, I would imagine. It'd be a mouse-sized hole. But if you've got a hole in your oven, I think that is a whole other issue that you should probably get a person in to have a look at that. Promise me you'll do that, Wendy. Weybridge. Ray. Yes, Ray. Oh, Ray. Too late.
Good morning. How are you today?
Yes, Ray.
Hello.
Let me say it again.
Are you there? Can you hear me?
And for the last time.
Right, good evening, good morning, Rabbi.
Yes,
first,
yes,
I want to pick some bones with you, Pet Shop Boys. I love Pet Shop Boys.
Is that right?
Can you hear me?
No. Try again. Call in about half an hour. I won't be here to talk about this. Let's chat to Alexander Larman. Alexander is journalist and author of Windsors at War and Crown in Crisis. Hello, Alexander.
Hello.
Crown in crisis. Is that over-egging it?
It's interesting because I've seen people say that this is a constitutional crisis in waiting, but I would say that that's completely inaccurate for one very simple reason. As Prince Harry has so adroitly pointed out in the title of his book, he is the spare. There was never any possibility that he was ever going to become king, and certainly now that Prince of Wales is married and has children, he's gone further down the line of succession. So to call this a crisis, certainly on the level of the abdication crisis, is vastly over-egging it. But what it is, it may not be a constitutional crisis, but it's a reputational crisis, because what I think we can see is that Harry, either out of malice or out of stupidity, has caused a situation where he's essentially put this bomb at the heart of the monarchy. And what he's done is he's brought out a lot of things that they would prefer to have kept hidden. I mean, the relationship between the media and the royal family has always been a symbiotic one. It's always been one of mutual need. And because he's pointed out, I think, you know, correctly and accurately, there's a lot of briefing that goes on, which is perhaps not the sort of thing that the royal family would like known about, he's embarrassed a lot of people. And I think also, I mean, even if we leave aside the pages 1 to 16 revelations that are going to be coming out in the book, I think what he's also done, intentionally or otherwise, is he's burnt his bridges in terms of any kind of reconciliation with the royal family. And I think he's going to find a very lonely place out in the reputational Siberia he's exiled himself to.
Well, when you say reputational damage, are you talking about for him or the family?
Well, I mean, I don't know whether this came from him, from his wife, or from somebody else, but it seems to be a case of mutually assured destruction. But on the one hand, intentionally or otherwise, he's completely destroyed his own reputation. I mean, he's made himself a laughing stock. But he's also taken the wider royal family. And I mean, for that fact that I don't think anybody at the start of last week would have looked at Prince William and thought, this is a violent man who assaults his brother in a kitchen and knocks him to the ground. But whether or not that story is true, that is now going to be part of the Prince William myth or part of the Prince William reputation. So there's that. And also the fact that King Charles, I mean, in the extracts that we've seen so far, he's not coming out very well. He's coming across as cold, emotionally distant, a bit pathetic. And so you can see that if Harry has hated his family for years and he wanted to hurt them, he couldn't have done a better job.
Well, there's no evidence that he's hated his family or that he wants to hurt them, or really that he's become a laughingstock. He's being painted that way by members of the press because it suits them to do it. It sells copies and makes them money.
I think the frostbitten penis is the thing that I would refer to as the laughing stock. I mean, or having his arse slapped by an old woman who rode him like a stallion. I mean, details like that, they're going to make a lot more sense in the context of a book. And obviously it's unfortunate that the book was leaked the other day from the Spanish copy. But I think, yes, he is a laughing stock because what has been seen are all these prurient, ridiculous stories coming out into the open. And obviously the story about him having taken note of the 25 Taliban that he's killed, that's not a laughing stock story. That's something completely different. But I think that...
Well, what's your opinion on that?
Well, I mean, it's not something that I could personally judge, but I would say that from a security perspective, I mean, he has talked over and over and over again about his fears for his family and about how it's been vitally important for him that he has this security. And you think, of course, you know, he served in Afghanistan, he's going to have killed people. But it sounds... I mean, It's interesting because the way it was initially presented as a news story made it sound like a boast. And actually, in the context of a book, the pages have been released and it reads much more understandably, if slightly chillingly. But it's not going to help him. I mean, none of this is something that someone's going to read who's been thinking about Harry as a, you know, a bad person, a malevolent person, a misled person, or any of those things. No one's going to read any of these stories and think, oh, actually, I got him wrong. He's a great bloke. And, I mean, what I've been feeling for a while is that he and Meghan have given up on Britain. They're not interested in salvaging any kind of reputation here. It's America that they're looking at, and that's where they really want to be making their future, both personally and professionally.
Well, that's understandable, isn't it? I mean, in this country, every time he pops his head out the door, the press are going to be writing anything they possibly can. He just caused the rain to fall or the winds to blow more strongly, and... You would want to get away if you were subject to that kind of attention. But it just going back to the admission of the amount of people that he killed in Afghanistan, the very people that seem to be most exercised about this are the type that would have the Battle of Britain on heavy rotation on their TV. And in the Battle of Britain, in the Second World War and before and since, pilots put a little diagram of the number of planes that they've shot down on the side of their cabins. Now, if that's not boasting, I don't know what is. And yet those people are universally described as heroes. We make films about them. People write stirring music about them. It practically gets people of a certain age on their feet and saluting at the very idea of it. So it's okay for them, but it's not okay for him. I don't get it.
Well, I suppose that what we've always looked at is the idea that the Second World War was this very simple battle of good against evil, and the war in Afghanistan was something more complicated.
But that's political, though. That has nothing to do with the actual soldiering itself. The soldiers just obey orders and do what it is that they have been instructed to do. The politics of it, that's for other people. That's not for the guy with his hand on the button in a helicopter gunship.
No, but Harry tries to weigh in on the politics. I mean, in the full excerpt that's been released, you can see that he says that he thought that 9/11 was this vicious, cowardly attack, and that he felt that he was fighting a just war. So you can see from his perspective that he was doing something that he thought was morally right. And actually, there is a sense there of it not just being followed. I mean, because in a sense, yes, he's following orders, but his grandmother is commander-in-chief of the armed forces.
Yeah, but she doesn't have any. She has nothing to do with it. She's just a ceremonial role.
Of course, but on the other hand, I think that, you know, there's always been that very strong relationship between the royal family and the armed forces. I mean, it's almost obligatory that you would go and serve in the forces.
But don't you think it's just a bit curious that the Daily Mail, for instance, is now calling up the Taliban to ask them what they think and appears to be on their side on this issue? I mean, the whole world's gone completely insane.
What I'm most intrigued by is that the Taliban have a PR office. I haven't been expected for 2023, but there we are.
Yes. Right, so, okay, so we're not... I guess we're not too far apart on that issue, or are we? Because that seems to have been exercising people the most, that he's boasting about killing people in a war zone. I mean, what did people think that he was there for? Troop morale.
What I think is fair to say about Harry is that he isn't evil. He isn't a bad person. I think he's a very sad person. And I think that if you look at what's happened to him in his life, he's had a succession of horrible and miserable things happen to him,
yeah,
of which it has to be said, this is the latest. And what I think we need to get into perspective is we might think a lot of his actions are selfish or self-aggrandizing or possibly even hypocritical. And I think those are accusations that can fairly be leveled at him. But where we start to actually lose sight of things is that he's still a relatively young man. He's a young father. And I think that, you know, in his own possibly misguided way, he is trying to do what he thinks is right. But I don't think anyone's helping him. I mean, I think that he's stuck because he doesn't have access to the level of advice he would have had if he was still a functioning member of the royal family. I mean, he's got people like, you know, Netflix's lawyers are going to be his advisors. And to be honest with you, the people who are lawyers for Netflix are not the sort of people who are giving you unbiased advice.
Well, no, I mean, there's no real such thing as unbiased advice. But you say you talked about horrible things that have happened to him.
Yeah.
Mostly they were horrible things that happened to him because of the sort of coldness of the accurately named firm, which is his family. I mean, to make a small child walk that distance behind the coffin of his mother in public with billions of people staring at him, what kind of people are they?
Well, the trouble with that is that you've got to see it from two perspectives. But on the one hand, the Duke of Edinburgh was genuinely trying to do something decent. And he said, I know this will be hard for you, but I'm going to walk there and I hope you'll walk beside me. And that's a detail that often gets left out. The fact is, he was trying to do things in the way that he saw fit. It wasn't a gesture of sadism.
Well, no, I'm not suggesting that it is, but that sort of makes it even worse. That people in that family that were accepting the advice that you've just described thought that that was an appropriate thing to do to a child just seems absolutely extraordinary and really tells me everything I need to know about who they are.
It wouldn't happen now, would it? I mean, it's astonishing to me. 25 and a half years ago, times have changed a huge amount in that last quarter century. And yes, I mean, even at the time I was watching it, and I wasn't much older than Harry then, and I was thinking to myself, this is intolerable. You cannot do this to a child. And I've never really changed my opinion of that. I mean, I've never really altered my thoughts of doing something like that to young
children.
You say
times have changed, though, but they have in society at large, but it doesn't appear to have changed very much within the firm itself. I mean, there was a perfect example just recently of that lady-in-waiting who kept asking a black woman who was there where she was from, which sort of is indicative. If somebody so high up, so close to the head of the family, had that mindset, then it must be from top to bottom.
Well, yes. I mean, but the trouble is going to be is that when King Charles became king, there was a lot of speculation as to whether he was going to be some sort of reforming monarch. Probably the first thing he said is, I'm not going to be a reforming monarch. I'm going to carry on business as usual. I'm going to honour my mother's legacy. And for everybody who took a sigh of relief and thought, oh, thank God, he's not going to try and actually intervene with state business. He's not going to try and become this unelected, you know, president, if you like. There's somebody else who thought, well, actually, hang on. The monarchy does need change. It does need a fresh approach. And if we're waiting for William to become king for that to happen, I mean, I don't know how long we're talking, you know, 20 years, 10 years, whatever, it's not guaranteed that he's going to do it either. And so the question is, you know, there's this poll, top poll today that suggests that young people don't really see the royal family as having any kind of impact on their lives, but they're much more warmly disposed towards Harry and indeed Meghan.
Yeah.
Because they don't think that Harry and Meghan's done anything wrong. They see this antiquated institution.
I'm with the kids. I really am. I get the feeling that the reason that the press are so vociferous in their obvious hatred for Harry, but particularly Meghan, is that you remember the day of their wedding, that sparkling day. Yeah. It seemed to be have the sort of the dust of magic on it that day. And the press must have been absolutely giddy because they had something new and sparkly about the royal family. Because the thing about the Queen is she sort of glided through what was required of her in pastels and jewels, and she just looked like, like some sort of heroic figure from a Disney cartoon. Charles, on the other hand, is the complete opposite of that. Shows up in tweeds and talks about vegetables. I mean, it couldn't get further away. So with him, there is no sparkle. There is no it, pizzazz. But with Harry and Meghan, they had that in abundance. And the thing that really irks the press to this day, and probably will forever, is they refused to lead their lives according to the script that had been written for them.
I think that's true, but then also, I mean, you say what a magical day the funeral was. There was certainly many of us like the funeral, Freudian slip, the wedding was. But there were also aspects of it I found very peculiar. For instance, all these film stars turning up.
That's not peculiar. That's her friends. That's her work colleagues.
No, she didn't know them. I mean, Tom Hardy turned up, and someone said, Tom Hardy, how do you know? He said, I don't know, I've just been invited. And there's a real sense that day of there were sort of people coming to fill the pews because they were famous and their faces fitted. And I think you could always see there's artifice there. And I mean, you know, everything that we've seen from Harry and Meghan, there has always been a carefully staged, managed creation of brand Sussex.
But that surely is you could say the exact same thing of the royal family for the entire existence of that institution.
You can and you should, because the thing with the royal family is that I completely agree with you. It is an institution that needs to be examined and interrogated. And I was just talking to somebody this morning, actually, who said that she'd been on a radio show in the wake of the Queen's death, and that she tried to advance not even Republican sentiments, but moderately questioning sentiments about our reaction to the monarchy. And she was shut down immediately. And she thinks to herself, well, that's a shame, because we have a free press in this society. We have broadcasters who actually should be able to allow, if not dissent necessarily, questioning of what the monarchy is for. And as soon as we just start to get into this rather dull routine of, it's wonderful, let's all wave flags, let's all get on with it, then you're actually, that's something very un-English about that, much more like communist China.
And just finally, I mean, we've talked about the, other people have as well, and I think this, you started by mentioning this, that looking at the end of the royal family, you know, sort of a constitutional crisis. Isn't the constitutional crisis that the current king and the next in line aren't that interesting? They just will not catch young people who are at the moment not interested, and nor will they become interested as they get older. So it become ever more irrelevant and just fade away. But the blame will be put on Harry for all of this.
Well, I think for constitutional crisis, putting it a bit strongly, I think reputational crisis is more what I'd call it. But yeah, I mean, I can't see, I mean, famous last words here, but I cannot see either Charles or William doing something electrifyingly interesting in their reigns. But then, in a sense, I mean, look at a man like George V, he wasn't an interesting king. He was somebody who was, he was king for quite a long time, but he didn't do very much. It's interesting because, in a sense, monarchy echoes politics. So when you've got an interesting monarch, things tend to go slightly wrong, because it's like when we have an interesting prime minister, and I use that word advisedly, there tends to be drama and event, just as if there's an interesting monarch. Things become, yeah.
I
mean,
I think it would benefit us all to go through a period of boredom, don't you?
But then, in a sense, that's exactly what the Queen did. She made the whole institution of monarchy a dull one, because nothing really happened. I mean, that's actually one of the problems with the crown. It's that you've got vast sections of it, but nothing's actually really happening. Whereas if you had the Harry and Meghan story, God, it's just endless drama, endless excitement. Yeah.
Good to talk to you, Alexander. Thanks very much for that. Alexander Larman, journalist and author of Windsors at War and Crown in Crisis. Whitfield, Simon.
Hi there, Nick. How are you?
Good, thanks.
Good. I've got a couple of things to talk about today, or this morning. First thing's my my grandma. She broke her hip, unfortunately, just before Christmas, and she had to wait 2 days for the ambulance to come out, which I think's, I don't think's acceptable, really. You know, having the fact that she broke her hip, and they took 2 days to come out to attend to her.
Yeah.
So I just think the NHS is failing at the moment. I think it's really struggling under the pressure. I'm not too sure what the outcome will be, but I think it's failing at the moment. And the second thing is I can't remember their name, but they were going on. They mentioned about the cannabis oil and stuff. I think the fact that it's not legalized at the moment is because of the taxes.
It's not legal because of the taxes.
I think because of the tax implications. Because. Yeah, I think because they will, because it could be taxed too much. I think it's not viable at the moment.
That makes absolutely zero sense, Simon. I don't really know where you're coming from or where you're going to. A mobile, so I don't know where he is. Phil.
Hello.
Where are you, Phil?
I'm in Chislehurst.
Ah, how is that?
It's not too bad. I've got work in a couple of hours. All I wanted to say is, let's be a little bit more positive about things, Instead of, like, as soon as you turn on the news, it's doom and gloom.
Yeah.
You're banging on about how the country's in turmoil.
Mm-hmm.
I bet you get paid more than most people, but we won't go there. Dying.
But just because I'm paid more than most people, if that is the case, doesn't mean to say that I have to make things up about how great the country is. Most people are having a terrible time right now. So can I not reflect that? And as for the news being depressing, that's the news.
No, I get that. But it's nothing to do with your pay, because everyone gets paid. But what I was saying is, when you turn on the news, everybody's telling you
depressing.
That. But most people are just getting on with it, aren't they? Going to work, doing what you've got to do.
Yeah, going to work, not being able to afford to heat and eat, having no real way of getting out of the predicament that they find themselves in, just trudging along through life, just about getting by. Yeah. On the other hand, let's be happy. Forget all of that. Every now and again, you just have to. And that's where this kind of thing comes in. Just forget all your worries and pack up your troubles in your old kit bag. Stanwell, hello, Michael.
Hello, Nick. We haven't got much time left.
Haven't we?
Well,
do you know something I don't?
Well, I do. I've been cut off before. It gets a quarter past, so I'm a little bit...
Oh, right.
Okay, listen, a quick rundown. I'm a big fan of Harry and the way that he's exposing the monarchy.
Mm.
I phoned in to another Nick one early morning because, you know, the public was saying how disgusting it was that he wasn't turning up for the coronation. And I phoned the other Nick and I said, look, the problem is that he lives in the States and his money is coming in through, you know, the companies in America. What he doesn't want to do is come to a big get together with the family when his uncle's there that was just proven, or paid off.
Yeah. No proof of any kind whatsoever. Go on. No.
Well, I won't step over the line. And what happened was his uncle got COVID just at the time that he was at the ceremony. So it all sort of worked out nicely. So I'm a big fan of him. But what I don't understand, Nick, is how you somehow think it's okay for him to tell the public about the people he's killed.
You know those black and white films like the Battle of Britain and all that stuff. Do you remember on the side of the planes they actually painted the symbol of the plane that they had just shot down? Planes that were crewed by human beings. So they used to boast about it in World War II, and we call those people heroes and make films in their honour. But now it's not okay.
That was just, though, because, you know, we hadn't invaded a country and taken over illegally.
That has absolutely nothing to do with it. That's an irrelevance to the conversation. It's completely irrelevant to the conversation that we are having. It was a war. We were at war. We sent the military in there to do the job, and they weren't sent in there to be social workers. They were sent in there to kill. That's why we provided them with the machinery of death. Utterly irrelevant about the politics of it. The people who were doing the fighting weren't concerned with the politics of it. They were just obeying orders. Utterly irrelevant. But nice try, Michael. And as you said, time is short and rapidly running out. Everybody's talking at me.